Hello everyone, my name is Camryn Counsil. I am a sophomore research fellow through the Civil War Institute at Gettysburg College, and today I am here along Cemetery Ridge in Gettysburg, Pennsylvania. Today I'm going to be talking about a story of a group of men who were deemed unmanly after a crushing surrender during an earlier part of the war. For the 126th New York Volunteer Regiment, they were deemed the Harpers Ferry Cowards after they had to surrender at the Battle of Harpers Ferry. However, during the Battle of Gettysburg in July of 1863, Pickett's charge gave these men an opportunity to change that narrative. This relates to the greater themes of masculinity during the American Civil War and what exactly constitutes a loss of honor in the first place. The 126th first encounter with battle occurred at the Battle of Harper's Ferry that lasted from September 12th to the 15th, 1862. Confederate General Robert E. Lee saw Harper's Ferry, which was in Virginia at the time, now West Virginia after it became a state in 1863. He saw this spot as a strategic place to capture because it was the joining spot of two rivers, the Potomac and Shenandoah Rivers, as well as the surrounding mountains of the Blue Ridge mountain chain. Lee sent his generals, notably Stonewall Jackson, to surround the main town of Harper's Ferry from the surrounding hillsides of Maryland Heights, Loudoun Heights, and Schoolhouse Ridge. This is where the 126th New York comes into play. They had only been active for 21 days prior to this engagement, as they had been mustered in late August of 1862. An officer claims that these men had, quote, never held a gun in their hands until the boxes were opened and the muskets issued to them. On the 12th and 13th, they managed to defend against Joseph Kershaw's brigade on Maryland Heights. However, their colonel, Eliakim Sherrill, was wounded in the face and was carried off the field. Leadership in 19th century warfare was a big deal. These officers had to represent the highest qualities of masculinity, bravery, and stoicism. They also had to inspire the men beneath them to follow their lead. So, when the 126th lost this sense of leadership, many of them quickly fled, and this is when things started to go downhill. The garrison's commander, Colonel Dixon Miles, was absolved to do whatever he could to protect the ferry, even if that meant using mass amounts of ammunition and sacrificing his men's lives. However, as the Union continued to be surrounded, Colonel Miles saw the futility of the situation and quickly decided to surrender. The total number of the Union surrender was almost 13,000 men. This would be the largest surrender of federal troops up until the Battle of Bataan in the Philippines during World War II. So, in short, this was a massive amount of men during this time. As David Silkenat writes, this sense of betrayal seemed most pronounced in the soldiers who had yet to fire a shot during the siege, and among those who had only recently enlisted. To surrender in their inaugural experience in combat, they worried, suggested that they lacked the masculine discipline to face combat bravely. The 126th New York was paroled at Camp Douglas near Chicago, Illinois, until November. Now, they gained the nickname of the Harpers Ferry Cowards because their surrender wasn't seen as honorable. There were some cases in the Civil War in which surrender could be honorable if the officers had careful discretion and also a great consideration for the potential risk of life if the fighting were to continue. Critics believed that Dixon Miles' actions were out of cowardice and panic. Northern newspapers and an eventual investigation believed that, quote, Colonel Miles' incapacity, amounting to almost imbecility, led to the shameful surrender of this important post. So while these men received the nickname of cowards, Miles wasn't even alive to hear his name being slandered, as he was killed in the formal process of surrender during the Battle of Harper's Ferry. The men of the 126th New York were upset at their officers because they didn't believe they had a fair chance before they were told to prematurely surrender.
As a soldier notes that the indignation of Union men and officers at the surrender was terrible. Some sobbed like children, some swore, some were angry beyond words. Another soldier recalled that I have never seen 10,000 men all terribly angry in my life but this once.
After their release from Camp Douglas, they became a well-trained fighting unit. However, they would retain this nickname of cowards up until the Battle of Gettysburg in 1863, where their actions during Pickett's charge on the third day of battle would redeem them in the eyes of many. 126th was under the command of Eliakim Sherrill, who had previously been wounded at the Battle of Harpers Ferry. This brigade served as the rightmost force here along Cemetery Ridge, close to the angle where I'm standing now. During this time, they were able to push back the Confederate forces during Pickett's charge that came from the opposite Seminary Ridge. They even managed to collect a number of enemy flags. A soldier from the 126th wrote that, quote, "I had never seen men so wild with excitement as we were when they retreated, and we pursued them for some distance until we were ordered to fall back. We captured 5 strands of colors, one of which had inscribed on it, among other battlefields, Harper's Ferry. Such cheers and shouts that greeted it as it was handed to General Hayes, who rode along the lines dragging it on the ground, are seldom heard. It was the most jubilant moment of my life." The 126th New York had over 200 casualties, with one of them being Colonel Sherrill. Even though he died, many believed he had redeemed himself after the previous embarrassment at Harper's Ferry. In a newspaper clipping talking about his funeral service, the author writes, "This was Colonel Sherrill's soul, a shadow of it, and his spirit influence, which we know should bend yearningly and protectingly over the nation until the nation should no longer live, and all of us proud Americans should worship and know of a truth, the living of this man's valorous deeds." This seemed to be the public's consensus regarding the 126th New York, as newspapers hailed, "Harper's Ferry and whatever of disgrace may have attached to this regiment in connection with the battle and surrender of that place will fade away and be forgotten, paled in the blaze of valorous light which encircles them as the heroes of Gettysburg." So, what does this all mean? Well, for one, it took almost 9 months for the 126th New York to feel as though they had redeemed themselves, and it only occurred after the Battle of Gettysburg. Perhaps because this battle was national news, as newspaper editors immortalized the battle here, especially during Pickett's charge, as everyone wanted to tell the tales of heroism during the fighting here. The 126th New York's efforts might have fallen into this category, and as a result, their story of redemption was more widespread. We can't know for sure, though, why this might have been the case. This leads to the bigger question, if the Harpers Ferry cowards even lost their honor in the first place. While we can never experience for ourselves the type of fighting that was included during the Civil War, we know from many firsthand accounts that it was very violent and, most importantly, chaotic. Even with the officers' best intentions, battle was not as neat or organized as they might have liked. Yet, in the Civil War, many had a sensationalized as well as sentimentalized view of these soldiers. They expected them to be unmovable, brave men who represented all the highest qualities of valor during battle and would do anything to serve their country. However, this is a large generalization that doesn't take into account the horror of warfare, and even the most bravest, courageous men could still be thrown off by the chaos of war. This is especially true for the 126th New York Volunteer Regiment during the Battle of Harper's Ferry. They were a brand new regiment, and they were fighting on terrain that was rugged and unfamiliar to them. They also lost their leader during the middle of battle. So with all of these things considered, it makes sense why they weren't seen as honorable. So, as you remember this redemption story of the Harper's Ferry cowards, also consider why the notions of masculinity during the American Civil War served to create this nickname for the 126th New York Volunteer Regiment, and ask yourself if there even needed to be a redemption story in the first place. Thank you, everyone.